Good evening and welcome to the It's All Greek to Me blog tour. This is blog number 23 and I'm Dr. Paul Kyritsis. Today we're going to be talking about the labyrinth and we'll be proceeding with a discussion relating to the labyrinth motif. The idea of a labyrinth being built beneath the Knossian temple palace to imprison the likes of a theriomorphic creature in the Minotaur wood, to the rational majority at least, demonstrate outlandish absurdities that the musings of a hyperactive imagination can at times come up with when it has little else to do. Thus, to gain a firm grasp or understanding of where the concept of the labyrinth may have originated, or what it may have initially defined, we'll have to delve into a whole nexus of meanings implicated by both the etymological root of the word in question and its cross-cultural luminosity. The story of the labyrinth need not preclude inheritance from the neighbouring civilization of Egypt, given that the archetypal forces of the Taurian Age pursued an avenue of pictorial expression identical in both Crete and Egypt. There is evidence to suggest that a labyrinth was constructed in the area of the Giza Plateau sometime in the 19th century BCE under the pharaoh Amenemhat III. It proceeded in S-bends and circular pathways, tracing out bodies of water that coursed through the subterranean in attempt to map out the electromagnetic anomalies generated by the Earth's formative forces. As a whole, the meanders imitated the Duat, the Egyptian underworld, and initiates into the cult of the bull god Osiris supposedly induced altered states of consciousness before dancing along the track in an attempt to recreate the drama of the souls wandering after death. Perhaps it was vigorous trade that brought the famous tale to Crete by a sea route which linked the southern part of Gatozahros with Avaris, a bustling Egyptian town in the Nile Delta. Or was it? Of interest here is that the Egyptian version identifies the meandering forms of the labyrinth to be one and the same with the routes delineated by the ancient dances of the astronomer priestesses of Knossos, which imitated the movements of the sun, the moon, and Venus as they traced intricate geometrical patterns in sidereal space around the earth. This tenet is vindicated by a latter reference made by Swinburne poet Homer in the Iliad, in which he describes an elaborately crafted dance floor at the temple palace of Knossos, identical to the one that had been made by Daedalus for Ariadne, the daughter of King Minos and Queen Pasiphae. Writing nearly a millennium after Homer, Plutarch explains that upon having reached the Aegean isle of Delos, Theseus and his fellow conspirators performed a celebratory dance to commemorate the slaying of the Minotaur. The dance itself, known as the Chronotechnophagia, or crane dance, not only imitates the winding courses which typify the labyrinth symbol, but recapitulates in whole an elaborate mating ritual between cranes in which sinuous movements are performed from left to right and then repeated again in reverse order. Cranes are migratory birds that desert their meticulously built nests in the Aegean as the end of summer approaches, and flock across to the African grasslands. There they spend the entire winter before returning to the same nests at the beginning of spring. For the astronomer priestesses who already sought to reunify the differing aspects of creation through ritual and perceive its holistic wholeness through divine epiphany, the departure of the cranes at the end of winter would have no doubt constituted a material expression of the soul's wandering after death, their prolonged absence a corporeal reflection of the unseen transformative process, and their return again in spring, evidence of the soul's eventual rebirth or resurrection. The epiphany itself, incited through frenzied and orgiastic rites, was quintessentially an all-encompassing encounter with the holy feminine formative powers of the earth and the attainment of knowledge which underpinned the conception and generation upon which all corporeal life is hinged. As a result, to have an epiphany was to attract to oneself holy intuitive knowledge regarding the soul's transformation after death and its eventual resurrection. Thus far, Egyptian discourse and classical Greek myth have both disclosed that the connection between the meander, the underworld, and dance patterns would have been made during the Taurian Age, if not earlier. Even the etiological root of the word in question seems to suggest this. The word labyrinthos derives from lavris, a Lydian word which means double-headed axe. In turn, labyrinthos denotes the place of that or house of the double-headed axe. Double-headed axes were sacred implements central to the Minoan culture and were used by the astronomer priestesses in the ritual slaying of the bull. This said, we should also remember the first cogitation of the implement was never a corporeal affair. It was entirely celestial. On the star-spangled body of the celestial goddess, a phenomenon clearly visible to anyone pondering the night sky during the Taurian age, the mouth area in which the double-headed axe was imagined to exist marked the western horizon. It was the place where the sun's diurnal journey came to an end, the place where it was swallowed by the goddess's mouth after being hacked to bits by her double-headed axe. The sun's act of being swallowed into oblivion was a death of sorts, hence the astronomer priestesses would have vindicated that the zone in question marked a definitive place of transition from living to non-living realms. For people whose collective psyche was celestially orientated to begin with, there can be no question that the place or house of the double axe explicitly connoted the celestial gate which led to the underworld. The shape of the labyrinth as a material manifestation of the intangible underworld is certainly in sync with the convictions of our very primitive ancestors, with its dark and obscure passages mimicking the convoluted celestial routes which the soul was supposed to navigate in its endeavour to reach the circumpolar stars of eternity, and its blind alleys reflective of anxieties that the uncertainty of death would have no doubt inside it. Just like the ancient Minoans and Egyptians, the Paleolithic and Neolithic culture that thrived on Crete envisioned the abode of the underworld as a series of water-filled winding passages beneath the surface of the earth. The earliest representations of this symbol, drawn on rocks, gypsum, and limestone caves by our tribal ancestors, closely resemble the labyrinth depicted on the spiraling dance forms at the Minoan temple palace of Knossos and Hagia Triada, on a clay tablet unearthed in the Peloponnesian town of Pylos, as well as on ancient coins dating to the classical era, so about 350 BCE, that were gathered from the hill of Kefala during the time that Sir Arthur Evans was excavating there. Therefore, it appears that when the first Neanderthals were being drawn onto the walls of caves, our primordial ancestors had already envisioned the living, tangible connection which underran the serpent, underground water, dancing, and the underworld, an association henceforth exemplified in the labyrinth pictogram. That the images of serpent, underworld, ritual dance, and subterranean water had all been identified as dynamic components of the same labyrinth symbol as long ago as the Paleolithic and Neolithic periods is curious. For as we have seen, in our investigation of consciousness thus far, our primitive ancestors developed their cosmogony through intuitively felt knowledge. They never attributed otherwise heterogeneous concepts or objects to the same pictograms or ideograms unless there was an intrinsically felt truth to the enterprise. Hence, what remains to be answered is how this connection may have been established, what phenomenon may have underpinned the said concepts. The only natural occurring one which garners an integrated and holistic understanding of the same four concepts that I can think of is the Earth's geodetic force, otherwise known as geodetic lines. In actual fact, it wouldn't surprise me at all if the Minoan temple palace of Knossos was constructed on a geodetic hotspot or at the intersection of such lines by astronomer priestesses who understood their significance and could appropriate the energies which emanated from the paths they traced along the earth.